In 1997, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone hit bookshelves and changed the game of young adult literature. The default publishing model before then focused on smaller books released quickly, in large volumes, the more successful series stretching into the tens or even hundreds of books. The Babysitter's Club, Sweet Valley High, Goosebumps, Animorphs, 100 to 150 pages. With Harry Potter, larger books with more time between them became the preferred style, sort of like moving from television to film. Of course, there's no clean transition. While Animorphs creators Catherine Applegate and Michael Grant have transitioned to a post-Harry Potter format, R.L. Stine has been churning out Goosebumps books like it was still 1993. And then you get weird transitionary books that feel like they were made for one publishing format, but ended up being the other. Case in point, Melinda Metz's Fingerprints. Beginning in 2001, this seven-book series tells the story of Ray, a popular high school student who discovers that when she touches someone's fingerprints, she reads whatever thoughts they were thinking when they left them. When this ability first manifests, she assumes she's gone insane. There are literally voices in her head that don't make sense out of context. And there's actually a family history of mental illness. Ray's mother died institutionalized when Ray was just a baby. But even when Ray realizes what's going on, that she's mentally fine, just she has some weird superpower, things only get more complicated because someone is trying to kill her. A revenge for something involving Ray's mother years ago. Fingerprints was the second series for Melinda Metz, the first being the very popular Roswell High series, though Animorphs fans might recognize her as one of that series' many ghostwriters, ghostwriting number 29 The Sickness and number 34 The Prophecy. Knowing this, a lot of your attention while reading Fingerprints is on the various parallels between the two series. Ray is short for Rachel. She's a beautiful, popular girl at school with gifted supernatural powers, and she starts off dating a guy named Marcus. No, Fingerprints is not some kind of secret commentary on how Metz really felt about Animorphs, it's just some pretty amusing similarities. While some bigger science fiction elements creep into the later books, for the most part, Fingerprints is a smaller story with a more personal conflict, more interested in how Ray deals with what she first perceives as a mental illness, and how she makes her way through the American mental health care system. It can get pretty intense with that stuff, dabbling in subjects like self-harm. About to read you a bit, so be ready. Somebody'll probably ask if they gave you electric shock. Ray shook her head as she rinsed the conditioner out of her hair. She twisted the hot water knob to the right until the shower was as hot as she could possibly stand it. Loofah. She needed the loofah. She reached up and snagged it off the little ledge under the high bathroom window, then squirted on a line of her new bath gel and started to scrub her shoulders. Somebody'll probably ask if they gave you electric shock. Ray scrubbed harder, straining to reach the center of her back. She'd already washed her hair three times and conditioned it twice. She pushed down on the loofah, really working it. Somebody will probably ask you if they gave you electric shock. She could feel the thick fibers of the loofah doing their job. Use some muscle, she ordered herself, grinding the loofah into her skin. More gel, that's what she needed for truly flawless skin. She grabbed the tube and positioned the loofah underneath. Oh God, she whispered. Oh my God. The loofah was streaked with blood. One thing Metz is clearly good at is interjecting an intensity to a scene. There are genuine gut-churning moments of anxiety and despair, and I had to stop reading just to catch my breath a few times. Animorphs goes into a lot of dark places as well, but it also has action and comedy to add levity to the entire thing. Fingerprints is mostly devoid of that. It's about awkward car rides with your dad and your best friend patching up your self-inflicted injuries. There's also the book's second protagonist, Anthony, a troubled teenage boy with a learning disability and a drug habit that everyone has pretty much written off, including the mental health programs he's involved with. Get a grip, he ordered himself. It's reading a few sentences. Mike, Anthony read. That was an easy one. A picture of his friend Mike flashed into his head as soon as his eyes hit the letters, so he instantly recognized the word. Ran. As soon as Anthony pictured himself running, the word had easily come to his mouth. He moved his eyes to the next word. Two. One of his heels started slapping up and down on the floor. Two, he said. He'd actually had to think about that one. Two letters, and he had to think about it. Removing the supernatural element in the story, and Fingerprints feels a bit like a Robert Cormier book, with the human ugliness of the chocolate war and the psychological haze of I Am the Cheese. Of course, there's the matter of if this book is an accurate representation of living with mental illness, which is something I've never felt qualified discussing. I don't know if this book presents a realistic portrayal of learning disorders. What I will say is that it feels like a realistic portrayal of the social stigmas of having a mental illness. When Ray returns to school after her power manifests and she spends some time institutionalized, her old circle of friends treat her with kid gloves, treating her with an unwanted level of pity and distrust. Her best friend is now distant. Her old boyfriend wants nothing to do with her, and a new student at school thinks that the crazy girl will make an easy lay. And again, Ray doesn't actually have a mental illness, just a superpower that's perceived as a mental illness. But that doesn't matter. Once you have that stigma, it doesn't wash off easily. Ray at least has the advantage of being in the upper middle class. Her and her father are doing pretty well for themselves. Anthony is poor and goes to a horrible school with special education programs that aren't interested in helping him improve his life, but simply containing him for the school day. The world has given up on Anthony, and Anthony's given up on the world in kind, losing himself in drug use. Anthony's principal has written the kid off to the point that he can't wait to find a reason to get Anthony expelled or even arrested and sent to juvie. When the story puts these two characters together, Anthony rightfully points out Ray's privilege in this, that even if her friends treat her differently, she'll never starve and she'll have plenty of opportunities in adulthood. There is a deliberate line between Ray's fantasy mental illness and Anthony's legitimate mental illness, and it drives a lot of the tension between these two characters. Which is good because there just isn't a whole lot of plot in this first book. And here's where we get back to the subject of structure. Gifted Touch, the first book of Fingerprints, feels like the first act of a much longer novel. The entirety of this 200-page book is Ray slowly, so slowly, realizing that her fingerprint reading powers is not a mental illness, but a supernatural gift. The book's entire mystery is what's going on with Ray. And the thing is, we know what's going on with Ray. They tell you on the back cover. The name of the series tells you it has something to do with fingerprints. The book is called Gifted Touch. Every single person reading this book knows what Ray's gift is from page 1. Ray doesn't know what it is until page 175. For comparison, imagine if the first Harry Potter book ended with Harry and Hagrid on their way to Diagon Alley, or if the first Animorphs book ended right after the kids escaped the construction site. Sure. A thing happened, a singular plot point, one lonely story beat, but then you don't really get to experience the consequences of that story beat, at least not until book 2. There's a subplot about someone setting off a pipe bomb, but since it also relates to the series' larger story arc, it's a mystery that doesn't really get solved. Ray uncovers one tiny part of it, a middleman of a much larger conspiracy, but since she doesn't discover her powers until the last couple dozen pages, she only has that much space to use her powers to solve this tiny part of this larger mystery. In comparison, the first Animorphs book did a lot more stuff in a lot less space. It introduced more characters, a massive science fiction plot with multiple villains and alien races, gave the characters time to learn and explore their new superpowers, threw in multiple subplots that built up to an action-packed finale that clearly set the stakes for the rest of the series. It told a complete story, an episode within the larger framework of the series. Fingerprints is trying to work with this old model of young adult publishing, but it doesn't feel like it was made for it. I can't confirm this, Melinda Metz hasn't given an interview saying as such, but Fingerprints feels like it was pitched as a longer, Harry Potter-sized book, but publisher HarperCollins wanted to publish it in the old model of Animorphs and Roswell High. I think the most damning bit of evidence to that effect is the sample chapter at the end of the book. You remember those? Those little teasers, you know, check your bookstore next month for the next exciting adventure? Do they still do that anymore? Gifted Touch has the first chapter of Fingerprint's second book, Haunted, at the end of the book. But I'll admit that I was rushing a bit when I got there. I was eager to finish this book so I could write this review, and I didn't realize I was reading the sample chapter. This sample chapter for an entirely separate book just felt like the natural continuation of the story in this first book, with Ray ruminating on her discoveries. The first 16 pages of Book 2 feel like the final 16 pages of Book 1. If Fingerprints wasn't intended to be a longer novel, it really should have been. I'm not sure if I would actually recommend Fingerprints. It's a bit heavy, a bit intense for such a pulpy format, a bit real for a story that will eventually involve, spoilers, a secret mad scientist lair. And I certainly can't recommend its first book, Gifted Touch, unless you're willing to commit to the entire series. Otherwise, you might as well just read the first 3 chapters of The Hunger Games and then return it to the library. It's a book series that's published and advertised as casual reading, but it certainly is not. And while that makes it an interesting footnote in the history of young adult publishing, I don't think it's enough to justify hunting down used copies.